All right. Hello. First of all, as a Swiss citizen, I'm very excited to have you all here. I don't think like our prolific and distinguished guests really need an introduction, but I'm still going to go ahead anyway. So we have Helen Hoehne, the president of the Hollywood Foreign Press Association, the organization that is hosting the Golden Globes Awards, and you're celebrating your 80th anniversary next year. And I hear you have a clip, right, that you brought. Okay, let's play the clip, please.
From the Coconut Grove of the Ambassador Hotel in Hollywood, the Hollywood Foreign Press Association presents the Golden Globe Awards.
For nearly 80 years, the Hollywood Foreign Press Association has built a foundation and a legacy.
This is absolutely extraordinary.
Now is our time to change the world.
The moments, iconic.
I'd like to give this to you, Mr. Jack Lemmon.
The artists who've held this stature, legendary. Yet, our roots run even deeper. From the sparkle of stars in front of the cameras to the craftsmen who bring passion to the screen. We continue our long-standing tradition, empowering the creators of tomorrow so they may transmit their message to all new audiences around the world and to build opportunity for these new voices. Our commitment to this mission has only grown stronger. We continue to strive to raise each other up, affect change on a global scale, and to provide a platform for all those with a story to tell.
Perfect, yeah, some Hollywood history right there. And then Matthijs, yeah, he's the CEO and the director of the European Film Academy, which was founded in 1989 by Ingmar Bergman, Federico Fellini, and Wim Wenders, among others. And then also very proud, we have Greg Shapiro, the Oscar-winning producer of The Hurt Locker from director Catherine Bigelow, and John Lesher, the Oscar-winning producer of Birdman from Alejandro González Iñárritu. And a little bit about myself, I'm very familiar with the topic we're going to discuss. What does the award season of the future look like? I first worked at the marketing department at the Weinstein Company and then for Scott Rudin. And so I've been familiar with a lot of Oscar and Tony and Emmy and Golden Globes campaigns. And then I have my own short film nominated, for which I did a campaign. And first of all, yeah, let's kick it off. So what does the award season of the future look like? I think much has been said about the current ratings decline of award shows. And I think there was a quite controversial quote, which I'm going to read. I think it's interesting to start our debate. So Francis Ford Coppola has said, "There are too many award shows now. I liked it when it was just the Oscars." What do you think?
Of course, I don't like that. Well, do you want me to start?
Yeah, please.
Okay, all right. Well, you know, I think that, you know, we obviously, we all know that award shows are declining. You know, the people don't watch award shows like they used to anymore. In 1998, actually, 55 million people tuned into the Oscars. And the winning movie at that time was Titanic. So, you know, things have changed since then.
Yeah, I looked that up. It was actually the most watched broadcast in Oscar
exactly.
history. And then this year it was like 16.6 million viewers.
It dropped to 16.6 million, yeah. So, and look, we have the same problems with the Golden Globes. You know, ratings have declined. So the question is, how do we, you know, how do we redefine, you know, award shows? How do we get better? How do we make people tune in again and get interested? Because the truth is, you know, since we don't really celebrate commercially successful films at award shows, you know, why do people tune in? What do they want to watch? And I think we all discussed this morning about streaming. You know, people watch things differently. It's not anymore that they just watch broadcast television. And the most, I think, live events broadcast television is, you know, people in the US, they watch NFL football. I mean, that's really our biggest enemy. That's what we struggle with. And I think you all know, next year, the Golden Globes are broadcast on a Tuesday. And that's because, you know, Sunday is deserved for NFL football. So we really have to redefine what we want to see on TV and how to get award shows exciting again.
And you have a simultaneous, obviously, streaming component, because Peacock is going to air, like, next to NBC, your broadcast partner, the show, right, live?
Yes. Yes, and we're very excited about that, because...
What's the date?
January 10th. Okay. It's a Tuesday.
That's early, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Put it in your calendar.
I'm just wondering.
Yeah, mark your calendars. We have to just see, you know, how people have really changed in terms of watching stuff, because people don't really watch broadcast television like they used to anymore. I mean, we talked about it this morning. People, you know, watch things on, you know, TikTok, you know, Instagram, Twitter. People are just, their habits have changed. So how do we get people excited again about tuning into award shows? I think the beauty about award shows is that they still bring the world together. I mean, we still talk about them. We talk about them at work, at school. We get excited about who won. And honestly, I mean, even in this room, who doesn't like to win? You still like to win, right? I mean, filmmakers like to win, actors like to win. So I think they're still relevant. We just have to make them more exciting again, and I think more fun.
I think you mentioned a good word, relevant. Relevancy has been brought up many times. Much has been written about that. And Matthijs, for you, I feel like now Bill Kramer has just shared his new vision, the new Academy CEO, about wanting to expand the Academy, like, its footprint more on a global scale. There's 25% members living outside the US. But generally speaking, I would say, we talked about this, like, when people talk about award shows, I think the Oscars come to mind first, then Emmys and Golden Globes. So what does the European Film Academy do? And there are crossovers with Another Round, I think, which wins the European Film Award and then does go on to win the International Best Feature Oscar. So I think, yeah, I heard you brought some slides. Do you want to elaborate on your vision?
Yeah, I'll answer your question first, and then I'll throw in the slides at some point. But thank you. I think, you know, the European Film Academy, I think, has a different aim. Even though we do an award show as well, it's not the main thing that we want to do, because I agree with Helen that award shows, I think, have an incredible power still, even though the context of it is changing, and of course the whole infrastructure around it is changing as well when it comes to support from TV and so on. The European Film Academy was never set up to be a huge TV broadcast. You just mentioned the people involved in setting the European Film Academy up are basically, and back then, and that's 35 years ago this year, we're worried about the fact that in Europe, and we're doing exactly the same here in Zurich, that we're talking about the American infrastructure and we need to adapt to it, but that's not what I want. And also not what the European Film Academy wants. So I think it's fine to say, listen, we're part of the world and European filmmakers deserve, I think, attention and an incredible, I would say, visibility as well, also benefiting from great international award like the Oscars, the Golden Globes, and so on and so on. But in Europe, we have a completely different aim, and I think we should stop pretending that we have to adapt or take all the flight to LA to make things work, because we're in Europe, we have a lot of things here, we have a lot of filmmakers here, and I think, coming back to your question, the Academy is there to unite European film makers in all fields of work, and to make sure that they get recognition as well. And the awards are one tool, and I think it's about time after 35 years to not just say, well, we copy-paste things that are being done in other award shows, but we start doing things in our own way. And that's what we're starting to do this year and in the years to follow. And I'm happy to say a bit more about that, but maybe I can show a few slides later on, because that's going to sort of also reveal a bit how we're going to switch things in Europe and do it differently from this year onwards.
I mean, I'm European originally, but I'm also an Academy member, and I looked into obviously the history of the Academy with Louis B. Mayer. That's when the notion of the Academy started, with to improve the image, basically, of the film industry. And for you both, Greg and John, as producers, like, how important is an award season component when launching a film? You both have won the Oscar, and obviously there's a historical, I would say, historically speaking, an Oscar has led to box office successes, right? It's definitely a prestige and pedigree. So how important is it for you guys when you launch a film as a marketing and PR tool?
Can I go first?
Sure.
Okay. hugely important is the answer to that.
Before I go into this, I just want to acknowledge that the most recent Best Picture winner is sitting right there, Patrick Waxberger.
Round of applause, yeah.
Who probably should be up here for this, but it's an important distinction for me to make because Patrick not only won Best Picture for Coda, he was also the person who was responsible for marketing my film, The Hurt Locker, for buying the film and getting it out there. So Patrick can tell you it was amazingly important for the success of that film. The film, because it was a challenging film, didn't perform huge at the box office, but it reached a worldwide audience because of the advantage of the award season. Golden Globes as well. I mean, the entire circuit, the BAFTAs, but the Oscars was obviously a big one. So I think my understanding, and it's not that I've studied it so in depth, but when the studio chiefs built the first award show, it was functionally a marketing tool, right, to get out to the audience. And I think it's turned into a self-celebration in a good way, in a very positive, healthy way for the community, for people, for filmmakers to celebrate themselves. And that's an important component that'll never go away. But something's happened where we're not, the awards season isn't speaking to the audience as much as it used to, whether it's because the films aren't as popular. Now, I don't even think that's it, to be honest. I think that good films really penetrate no matter what. But it does need to sort of be forward thinking and understand that everybody shares in the experience of great art, and we should be speaking to those people.
I mean, to your point, actually, I know many people watched Coda specifically after it won Best Picture.
Well, Coda's a great film. It's also an incredibly crowd-pleasing film, and I think that that's part of the reason why it was so much love around it. Birdman, too.
Yeah, I mean, I think when you're making a film, all you can try to do is try to see if you can make a film that can connect with people. When you get to the place, and that process is really long and hard and very subjective. When you're sitting down though and trying to figure out how we're going to sell the film, then obviously, okay, does it have awards potential, and how are we going to build a campaign to do that? The award shows themselves, I think, are also really boring. So there's,
except for the Golden Globes. No, seriously, it's the most fun award show.
Yeah, definitely.
Alcohol helps.
So I think part of it is like, what is an award show, and then how do you make films that connect with audiences more so they actually. But it is a celebration of filmmaking and our values and what we and artists from all over the world who come together. So it is, and yes, it's fun to win, but it's also fun to be part of that experience and meeting people and going all around the world with your movie and talking about film because it really still matters to us.
Yeah, I agree with that. It sounds like a cliche, but it's actually true. It really is. It's the overall experience, the award season it's very stressful, but it's also, you end up building relationships that you keep forever. I have.
You know,
it's very strong memories.
I mean, also to define real quick, like generally for the American audience, the awards season starts after Venice or TIFF, when sort of like predictions are being made. And I feel like also now here at Zurich with All Quiet on the Western Front, which is presented, and Germany's entry. And you also, from your studio experience, because you were there for There Will Be Blood and No Country for Old Men, how, like, did you early on knew that those were Oscar contenders and then also basically campaigned for that?
I mean, that was the hope when we were making it, and certainly that was the plan going into marketing and selling those movies on not only in the U.S. but worldwide, and that was a huge part of it. But you just don't really know, It's there's so many things that people either connect with or don't. But I do think that all that energy and effort and the kind of machinery of that does give attention to the films that maybe otherwise people wouldn't see. So there's like sometimes fatigue, like, oh my God, there's another award show, another one of these things. But at the same time, I think the real thing is like, let's try to make good movies that connect with, that bring people together. There's so much crazy stuff going on in the world right now. I mean, it's the one thing that really does connect people together is cinema and filmmaking and streaming, and so, let's just try to make stuff like that. That's kind of where I am. And, we can look at all the problems, but there's so many bigger problems out there than what does the award season of the future look like. So that's kind of, I don't know. But I, But I think it's still great because people want to see things and people want to be moved. And there's an appetite for global cinema and storytelling and stories from around the world and diversity and things like that. So to me, it's an exciting time.
I mean, you mentioned global, like, because now Drive My Car from Japan did really well at the awards. Parasite, obviously the first picture to win Best Picture internationally. There's also for you, because there's a Best Foreign Language, right? Because your definition is different, right? Can you elaborate a little bit on that? Like how you define an international film versus the Academy? It's basically the language that it's spoken, but for you, it's the country it's from, or can you elaborate on that?
No, it is actually the language. So you have to be over 50% in a different language. But what I love about the Golden Globes is that we, we take, unlike the Academy that only takes one submission from one country, we open it up to everyone. So we take, really, if you had, 10 movies from Belgium or 10 movies from France, we watch them all, and we love that. I mean, we are the Golden Globes. We represent now, with the additional voters that we just took in, we represent 62 countries, so which I really love. And that really is, for us, the cornerstone of our organization, the global aspect of it, and really, yes, diversity, equity, and inclusion is also hugely important for us. It actually has been, this entire year, we've worked on that to make it better. And I think this is also what this industry is about, right? We want to include, be inclusive, and really look at the world. Because a lot of the projects now that are awarded are international projects. I know Netflix got a lot of criticism here, but those are the projects that we love. Squid Game did so well. I mean, won the Emmy, won the Golden Globe. There are other, La Casa de Papel, Lupin, I mean, just amazing projects. So, and I think it's exciting to embrace those. So, I love that about the Golden Globes.
You mentioned some slides. I think that would be a nice segue to, because I'd love to hear more about your mission and vision.
I'll make sure I show the slides so we have that out of the room. But before I do that, I actually want to react to you because it's a bit linked to that. If you say like we want to be inclusive, I think it's quite of a key word when it comes to the work that awards shows try to do, because I think what we basically see, I mean, we've all grown up with award shows the way they used to be. But we also are in a world right now in which the original format of award shows just doesn't work that much anymore, as much as regular linear TV doesn't work that much anymore the way it used to be. So that's not only on the side of TV and the people involved in putting money in it, of obviously something that they see because audiences are not there.
It's a reality TV show.
It's a reality TV show, but at the same time, it's not a reality TV show, because if you see the clip here, I mean, what is that reality is, it's all very exclusive, famous people that we see there. And of course, that is what people want to see. I mean, I would be the last one to deny that. But at the same time, I think we also live in a world in which the media portrays a very different way of people wanting to feel that they're a part of it and that they have a say in it and so on. That links, and now I'm coming with the slide, so that links to something I think that in the past 2 years at the Academy, we have European Film Academy. We call ourselves Academy too. We're also the Academy. We've been working on that because we felt, we represent 52 countries in Europe, and we felt it just to have an award show once a year, whether it's in Berlin or this year in Reykjavik in Iceland, we switch every year to a different city. In 24, we're going to be in Switzerland, actually.
Lucerne, yeah.
Yeah, so looking forward to that. We are sort of looking into how can we connect those 52 countries instead of telling people that on the 10th of December they maybe should switch on their television or go online and watch the award ceremony one evening per year. I think it's not that much, and I think in Europe itself, as a part of the international award season, we need to build up our own award season much more when it comes to everything that we as an Academy are doing, but also I would say the richness of all the European films that can be part of that award season. And obviously, you just mentioned Another Round, but I also want to mention the film Collective of Alexander Nana, who's actually here in the room, that also won an award at the European Film Awards, and then actually was nominated in international award categories as well, like the Oscars. So the award season for Europe that we're building up, we're launching it this year. It's going to be taking place in 35 countries that you see behind me. We're going to do activities there. We have partners there as well. We're going to do this in these cities. And if you look at these cities, you basically see that they're not only the capitals, because very often, I think, also in the cultural world, in the film world, we focus just on the capitals in Europe. But we also have picked sort of like, a mix of smaller towns, sometimes countryside places, where I think it's as interesting. And there's a lot of film lovers not living in capitals, so we sort of want to acknowledge that. And moving from that, we have flagship cinema partners here. So I'm talking about a cinema program here. We have other partners as well, but I'll come to that in a second. So it's going to be called the Month of European Film, quite a simple name. It's going to be a month, 4 weeks, in which we have programs with these partners. It's going to be in 35 countries. We have one flagship partner per country, but we're going to roll this out in the next couple of years. The idea, as the name says, it's a month in which everything that's related to European film is going to be celebrated, going to be seen, it's going to be highlighted, with campaigns around it. And obviously, those campaigns are going to be in the local languages, because Europe is not an English language speaking part of the world, even though here we're all very good at it. But in many countries, and mainly the audiences that we'd like to reach, that don't speak English in many cases, or not well enough to be part of it. So it's going to be in a lot of languages. I didn't count them, maybe not 35, but almost, I would say. We have done this, actually, and that's also the reason why we're speaking about it. We have done this last year in Berlin to try out. We're based in Berlin as an academy, and we are lucky to have amazing partners in the York Cinemas, which is the major Berlin art house chain of cinemas. Christian Breuer, here in the room, will be speaking later on as well. And with them, we tried this out in Berlin. It was a small start, 14 cinemas, but it worked quite well. So we highlighted a lot of European films, and audiences were sort of like made aware that the films they were seeing were European, linked to each other, and sort of we gave it a European brand, and that's what we're going to do in all these other countries. We also work with Mubi this year. I know Mubi is not the largest streaming platform in the world. It's also in a way quite exclusive, I would say, but it's a great partner for us because they have, I would say, when it comes to their programming, their curation, they're on the same line. They feel what the excellence of European cinema is. A large part of their program is European films. And in many cases, these films are not seen anywhere else. So they will basically, during the month of European film, also highlight 100 European films that will be made available to subscribers. And that's all under the label Month of European Film as well. And we are working with the European Broadcasting Union, which we will start next year, which means that all the public broadcasters of Europe that are part of this will highlight European film in the month of European film as well. When is the month of European film? It's going to be November, mid-November to the 10th of December. And it will end with the European Film Awards, which are in Reykjavik this year. So yes, we don't step away from the award ceremony, but what we're trying to do, and that's what I said before, we're switching it. We're not saying, well, the award ceremony is what everybody should look to. We want people to go watch films, whether it's on streaming platforms, on TV, or in the cinema, or for my part, on their cell phone, if people would like that. But as long as we, as an academy, with all the partners around Europe, can push that, we will know that an award ceremony in the end, where many of those films are nominated and win awards, will have a different meaning for people. And they might be interested, actually, in supporting it and helping to make it more widely known and more appreciated in Europe, which I think is necessary.
I mean, yeah, it's about exposure. John mentioned really nicely, like the award. Well, like in essence, basically, award shows are for exposure for movies, for cinematic excellence, and the award shows is just a culmination, because for me, it's a year-round, endeavor, so to speak. I'm just interested, of a show of hands, how many people have watched an award show in the past 2 years? I'm just curious, by a raise of hands. Okay, so. Like, how involved are you guys in the Academy, John and Greg? Because it's the Oscar, but then it's the Academy Museum right now, and the show now obviously is 3 hours long most of the times. Like, do you have any creative, you as producers, do you have creative ideas on how the show could become more appealing?
That's not my job at all. I mean, I have ideas as a viewer, you know, as an audience member, because it's long and it's slow and it's difficult to watch sometimes. And I think that people, there's sort of a duality to the way that I see it, because on one hand, I know there's a lot of categories that the public doesn't understand necessarily, but they're really important to the craft of filmmaking, and they deserve to be recognized. You know, in various years, the Academy has tried to move them off the show, and it always really upset me, because for me, it's part of the process, and they deserve the recognition. On the other hand, I understand that to the public, forward-facing, and the Golden Globes doesn't have as much of an issue on this because it's more of the creative awards and less the technical awards. But the audiences don't understand it, and so it's a really difficult question to answer, because the show would be more popular. More people would watch it if it was shorter and it was focused on the awards that people actually have an appreciation for, which are basically the actors and the picture and the director.
Perceived as glamorous, the above the line.
Exactly. But I for one, personally, would be disappointed if the technical awards were no longer part of it. So I don't claim to have a great understanding. I don't think anybody does. I think the Academy is still trying to experiment with what the right balance is.
I mean, do you think also, John, maybe the problem is, like, right now, you know, with cord cutting and everything, people are just not used to being specifically at a very certain time frame. They have to watch, like, World Cup. I think sports is very similar, like World Cup and yeah. Olympic Games, Wimbledon. So you have to be at a designated time, but people now, they want to watch stuff at their own leisure. So you think a streaming component could be the future for award season, John?
I mean, there is something about watching something live with, you know, collectively. I remember watching award shows as a kid with your family, with your neighbors, and that's like fun. Or you have Oscar parties where people get together, and there is something about the community of watching something together and celebrating film. And I agree with what Greg said. There's both the experience of watching the show, because sometimes I'm like, oh, that probably plays well when you're sitting in there, but also understanding what's going to play on TV and trying to find the balance of making a fun show for the people sitting in the audience and also making it so that it can be seen worldwide. Yes, I think global viewing habits have shifted, but as you said, if you can make it exciting and interesting and relevant to people, people will watch it. It has to be a good show. I think they failed because they just kind of do what they do, and it has a certain format, and it's long.
It feels a bit old-fashioned.
Yeah, it feels old-fashioned. I'd like, oh, that's really tacky. That's really corny. I'm kind of like, I want to like it, but why does it look like that? Or for me, I'm constantly just cringing sometimes at how bad I think it is. But that's just my own bias, I suppose. But anyway, for me, what I don't spend that much time thinking about this. I spend most of my time trying to think about how do we make movies that we care about that people want to see, and obviously the awards component is a key part of that. And how do we find talent from all over the world, bring them together, and make beautiful things, or try to make things that people want to see? That's really the thing that I spend my time thinking about. It's, you know, when you get to the awards season. It is sort of the end of a very long journey that you've been on.
Yeah, people don't realize that when it seems like a movie comes out and 6 to 12 months later there's an award show, but usually it's, at least I think in our experience, it's years, sometimes decades, yeah. of life that's leading up to it. So it's a big deal for the filmmaker.
Yeah, it's a big deal, and you know, it is the one part of the process that is pretty, like people always say, oh, being a producer is pretty glamorous. Well, when it's 3 o'clock in the morning and it's raining outside and you're freezing or someone's yelling at you, it doesn't feel that way.
It's a job.
It doesn't feel that way. But there are those instances where you go to a film festival, which is amazing, or you come to places like this, or you're at the Oscars or something where it all kind of, you feel like you're part of something that's bigger and it's exciting.
Yeah.
And it's fun not to lose the mystery. You know, we live in a very celebrity-based culture, and it's like Instagram, and people are just talking about like the wrong things about it's all. You know, in Venice, I was really excited because there's a celebration of films, but all anyone was talking about is like what certain people were wearing and who was doing what to whom. It wasn't so. It's like, but that's just our culture right now. So hopefully the pendulum will kind of...
Yeah, because I love you talk about the artistic achievements that, you know, to be
awarded. Yeah, but people are talking about what someone spit on somebody or someone was wearing this or, I mean, I don't, you know, that it's not even about the film. Correct. Yeah.
But I think that's actually, I completely agree with you, but I think that is an interesting thing, I think, and also the difference and the power of in that sense, a European award show, because in Europe it always has a political... component, and not a political component as in we're having a war in Europe and what we're going to do about that, which obviously will be one of the big things probably will surface also in December, but also the fact that, you know, Europe is is a continent in which, with all these different languages, cultures, histories as well, films talk about that, show what it is. European films is something different than, I would say, US American films, Latin American films, Asian films. So the political component in Europe is always that people feel all of a sudden that they're living in the same part of the world. And the European Film Awards are actually a manifestation of the fact that people realize that even though they speak Greek or German or Portuguese or Swedish, there is a common language when it comes to from which angle they see the world and experience the world. And I think talking about award ceremonies, because I understand, I mean, I've been a long time watcher of award ceremonies as well, and had exactly the same emotions as is cringing and it's not so good and why is it done like that. On the other hand though, organizing an award show, I mean, Helen knows more about this even than I do, but you know, wherever you do an award show, it's not so much about the award show itself, it's about what you want to create with the audience, whether they win or if they not win. It's about something you create that is related to the power of cinema. And it maybe might sound very esoteric and poetic, but I think it's an incredible, important thing that we shouldn't forget when we do award shows as well. So it might be about which dress is Florence Pugh wearing or who hit who on which award show. But in the end, it is about why are we sitting here and celebrating films and also celebrating the people who make these amazing films. And that should, I think, be much more at the core. In Europe, we have that. But obviously in Europe, we lack the history and also, I think, the self-awareness and the pride in a way as well to say, listen, we're not just going to make sure that everything ends up on a stage in LA, but we're going to make sure that it's celebrated here so it can be celebrated outside of Europe as well.
Are there any questions before I want to pass it on to the audience? Kim, no question?
Hi, Kim Magnusson. Just had a question. I mean, there's a little the flip side of what you're talking about, the award season, but maybe on the panel, just to some views on the ever increasingly campaign cost. Now we've just heard you guys talking about how long it goes on and saying for like decades. And I mean, we all know that campaigning is really, really costing something. We've seen during the pandemic, we could all be on Zoom and things like that, but it's still, you know, just increasingly costing something. And that has to do, in my mind, something to do with the award season. Do you guys think that that's going to trigger the award season in a way because of the cost? Or, I mean, it was an open question about the cost. You can take it whatever way you want.
I mean, it is very expensive to launch an award campaign. However, there's so many different ways of doing it. And I think, in general, people don't like to be beaten over the head. Yes, you have to travel people around. You have to campaign. You have to get people to see your films. There's lots of different strategies and different ways people do it. But Searchlight, which has won almost more Best Picture nominations than anyone, always would spend less than everyone, often spend less than other people on their awards campaign because the way they do it. But yeah, there's a whole machinery around publicists and you know, events and just, you know, all the dresses and the hair and makeup and all the things that go around selling your movie and your stars and stuff on a worldwide basis that is just mind-boggling sometimes. But you know, it's those are the things that get people to watch your movie. And sometimes it's interesting because when you're making a movie, you're saving every penny. Every time someone asks you for something, you're like, okay, I have to say no to that because I can't afford that because I want to put the money up on screen. But suddenly you get to the award show, the award season, and it's like, three publicists, sure. You know, it's just sort of like anything else.
Spending like crazy. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, the uncomfortable truth also, and I think there was some discussion earlier about streaming versus theatrical in one of the earlier panels, the streamers have deeper pockets and they can spend more. And so if you're an independent film distributed by an independent distributor, it's really hard to compete against something like Netflix, which has incredibly deep pockets and can spend more. And is that a level playing field? You know, I don't know. I don't think anyone's ever talked about the idea of creating parity or equity when it comes to what people can spend. It's a spending race, and sometimes
it's interesting. Yeah.
Sometimes that creates a terrible inequity. On the other hand, again, if you're a filmmaker, there's no filmmaker who's ever been nominated for any award who didn't want their distributor to spend as much as they possibly could. No one's ever said, please don't put out that extra for your consideration ad.
I mean, it's interesting, like sometimes the campaign budget is likely higher than the film production.
Yeah, and
budget.
What John was saying is when you're making a film, all you care about is putting everything on screen. And it's always, you're either someone saying no to you or you're saying no to someone else. And then all of a sudden you're in the mix and it's just flowing. The money's flowing like crazy.
I mean, but that still shows the cultural relevancy and the impact and the pedigree that comes. As maybe people don't watch it, but I would almost say that the following day, a lot of people know which people or films have won the award. So there's certain an amount of...
I mean, it's a complicated time because it's not like the old days where you could take ads on TV or ads in the newspaper and the trades. People's attention is diverted to so many different things. You talked about Twitter and Snapchat, all these different, so many different things. So how do you even sell things is different. You know, it's all about social media and stuff like that. And it's like, oh, I see it all the time. Like, oh, why are there so many influencers? I don't even know who they are. My son's like, oh, there's like 300 influencers here because they have their, and that's how they're selling your movie now. It's just, you know, I think I don't know what the point I'm trying to get to is, but it does cost a lot of money to do an awards campaign, and it is a component of it, and it is not a level playing field.
Well, we're trying to save some money here. That's why the Golden Globes, we implemented a strict gift policy, so no one's allowed to get anything anymore.
That's good.
So that will save the studios some money. And also when it comes to us, our voters are really, you know, there's a very strict code of conduct in place now, plus the gift policy that I just said about also traveling, that the studios can't, you know, pay for travel or take us to fancy dinners or anything like that, which
no,
I think
no dinners?
No dinners anymore, no,
okay.
No. So I think
you mentioned,
that's
so
important.
Helen, there's been a lot of changes with the Hollywood Foreign Press Association, and then obviously you're celebrating your 80th anniversary, so how are you gonna go about your awards show next year, which is again on NBC this year?
Well, we're looking at implementing some changes because, you know, as we just talked about, the award shows are changing, and how do we make it exciting again? And we're celebrating the 80th anniversary, which brings along an amazing history, 80 years, and we certainly have a lot to celebrate. But I think we're also looking at the future, and you know, we've gone through a lot of change this last year. Our organization really, as I said earlier, made you know, diversity, equity, inclusion really a cornerstone of our organization. We changed our governance because, as you know, a lot of the award shows are under fire, not just for diversity issues, but because of, you know, corruption, because of all sorts of other things. And we cleaned up. It, you know, took a long time, and it's still not, you know, we're still working on becoming better. And making this a very transparent process, and really, you know, having people engage in award shows again, and get them excited about tuning in.
Are there more members now?
We have more members. We admitted last year we had, you know, 21 new members, 21 diverse new members that came into our organization. We added 103 voters just recently, which brings us up to 200 voters this year, which we're thrilled about. You know, most of them are female, which I'm also very happy about, and the majority is diverse, which makes our award show the first award show really with the most, you know, women and diverse members. And we're excited. This is only the beginning. I hope we can increase those numbers next year and the following year, and really grow as an award show and become better. But yeah, it's going to be exciting to see the 80th. We're thinking of lots of ways to reinvent ourselves and make the show exciting, bring on an exciting host, and really make it a fun party.
Who's the host this year?
I'm not going to tell.
Well, you don't want to break news right here?
Not going to tell.
I mean, I think a lot of the pressure stems, I think, more from the network, because they want their ratings to go up. You know, that in turn has then more advertising, you know, and in turn makes the advertisers happy and gives more money when, you know, spending ads and stuff. But yeah, are there more questions? Yeah. Oh, right there.
He's on. Hi, Jason Loftus, director of Eternal Spring, which is Canada's entry in the international. And I wondered, because you mentioned how expensive these campaigns are, I'm not sure if this is the right group of panelists, but say you don't have a lot of money, right? Say you're an entry from Canada. And what are the things that you've seen in a campaign that have been effective that aren't necessarily sort of big ticket items? Is there anything that you've noticed or that you can think of that might be useful for someone in a situation like that?
For me, the most important thing is getting people to see your movie. Hosted screenings.
Yeah.
Basically just a screening program where you try to get as many people around the world to see your movie.
Okay, so should we cancel this panel and we all go over to see my film at the Cosmo?
So let's go.
No, John's, no, fundamentally John's right. It's, you could do as many TV ads or television or print ads. You need voters to see the movie and they need to appreciate it. So the screenings are the most important thing. If you can get someone to host a screening for you, that's a key thing.
To get what? Yeah, to have a really good, I think Patrick's right. Ask the master over there. You need a very, very good publicist who's out there talking to people, helping you position, strategizing. It's really about positioning and coming up with a strategy. So it's not just willy-nilly screening. As Patrick said, a really good publicist can help you craft a campaign for little money, that also understanding what category that you're trying to achieve in and how to get to the members of those different groups and how best to do that.
Yeah, thanks. We're working with DDA, so.
Okay.
But I was curious, if we're doing theatrical, do you see that as something, if we don't have the maybe the budget to participate in a lot of those big ticket events, you know, the showcases and such, can you use your theatrical to bring out members effectively?
Patrick, what do you think? Where is he?
Thanks.
Do you have an opinion on that?
I don't.
I don't know how you do that, but I think obviously theatrical is like an ad for your movie. So it's just another opportunity for people to get excited about your movie and people to see the movie. So it's you need a social campaign, you need people to see your movie, and obviously theatrical is a huge component of that. So
you have a lot of voting members, not only in the United States, but you really have to cover a lot of territory. You'll be surprised to see how many voting members exist in France, for instance, in the UK. So you really have to cover all of that. And it's really not about spending the money.
They people like being invited to a screening and meeting the people involved, and that really does make a big difference. So just talking about it, having someone, you know, invite some like members or people that can vote, and meeting you, that in a weird way matters more than just about anything. But you have to have, you can't just kind of willy-nilly do it. I think you have to really have a strategy for what you're trying to do. And if you're with DDA, I'm sure they can help you do that. And good luck on your movie, by the way.
I think I'm being told we're wrapping it up, but any final notes, or are you good?
Maybe I have one. We're going to have such a screening tomorrow, by the way, for the Swiss entry for the Oscars, because we have so many Academy members in town. It's called Tri Winter. So here you go. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. It was amazing. Thank you, guys. Thank you.